You made a great speech about the Black Sea region yesterday. I would like to understand more about the challenges of the Black Sea region and why would you prefer not to name it as a region?
Because I think that it's really the only non-region that is referred to as a region. If you look at it objectively, you have two very large countries, Russia and Turkey, bordering it. You have some countries that are members of the European Union, some that are members of NATO, some that aspire to be members of either organization. You have a plethora of international organizations, the Black Sea Economic Cooperation Forum and various other alternatives, yet you don't have that level of integration which you can see in areas like the Baltics, for example. And on top of everything, which makes things even more complicated, is the fact that you have all of these frozen conflicts in Transnistria on one side and in Abkhazia, Setia. You have all of these issues that in a way hinder cooperation, and we need to be much more innovative, perhaps less enthusiastic in our words about how we're going to do it, and be much more practical about the cooperation in the region.
Well, you spoke about difficult choices Bulgaria was fronted by the acceptance it in the European Union. Can you tell us more about it?
I spoke about the fact that when we were applying for membership in the European Union, and we started preparing for this back in 1999, our society had to face a bit of a schizophrenic situation, because on one side you have to prepare for accession, meet the requirements of the acquis communautaire, negotiations, etc. But on the other side. You had to transform your society from a centralized society coming out of communism into a liberal democracy, which meant not just private property, but develop a pension system, develop healthcare funds and institutions, and all of these. So at different points in time, these two processes may have clashed with each other, and it was a very, very difficult balancing act. So now that the accession process is over, Bulgaria is in the European Union and NATO, and our economy has been vastly transformed and has barely anything to do with what it was under communism. We see some of the leftovers of what governments were not able to deal with under those pressures, namely security and judiciary and fight against crime and corruption and all this. This is why these are our priorities right now, to make sure that we can resolve them, we can make sure that laws are abided by everyone, and that we have a situation in which actually people, what is generally referred to the public at large, can benefit from the benefits of membership in the European Union. And that can't happen until you actually have rule of law.
True. And how has the crisis affected the economic growth of the country?
The crisis has affected us just like everyone else, perhaps less so than some of our neighbors to the south and to the north, because the government took a very firm and largely criticized by many people decision to stick to a very constrained budget last year, to reduce the budget deficit to a minimum for last year and obviously for this year as well, which meant that we needed to find a lot of savings. And finding these savings, we had to look at either increasing taxes, VAT or property tax or income tax, or reduce public expenditure. And our choice went for reducing public expenditure and reducing the administration, because we believe that it is vital to stick to the achievement which Bulgaria has, which is the lowest tax base anywhere in Europe. So constraining the budget, constraining the public administration, means that now we have to face a very difficult choice. And that is, do we continue constraining this, constraining the budget for next year, Or do we use some budget flexibility, very limited, to leverage EU funding that the country needs to develop its infrastructure, to develop its agriculture, to develop its industries?
So we still can talk about some sustainability in the development of the
Indeed, and I think this is the reason why in our case we can, or in any case, in any country in Europe you can actually talk about this, is that you have the solidarity principle that the European Union puts in place. And you have, in our case, the ability to access EU funding, co-financed by the government, obviously, to develop projects that are important. But this means that now you have to be extra careful, double careful, how you spend those money, and whether what you spend the money on actually creates the jobs and creates the incentives for growth that you need. What we've seen over the last 6 months, I believe, the data has been quite conclusive, is that we've seen much stronger than expected growth in exports. And in industrial production. So this is the new turnaround, the new source of growth that mm-hmm. will come out for countries all across Europe, including us.
So the balance is returning.
Yes, some will say that we're actually going back to reality.
More normal stage. So thank you very much for the interview.